But I want to welcome you to the second of our two gatherings about the New Beginnings projects and changes and examinations. There are all kinds of wonderful things that are going to be happening. And I want to take this opportunity to talk to you about it. But first, I want to take an opportunity for us to begin with our Star King chalice lighting. So if you would join me as you are willing and able. With the kindling of this flame, we reaffirm our commitment to accept life's gifts with grace and gratitude, and to use them to bless the world in the spirit of love. Thank you all for joining me. I know it's 8:30 in the East, and I really appreciate all of you who are out that way. And I see some folks who are most likely here on the West Coast, but I'm glad to see you too. So I want to begin sort of as a refresher and a reminder to let you know that this is Star King's 115th year. We are 115 years old this year. And a reminder to all of you that we began in the parish hall of the First Unitarian Church of Oakland. And our first class had two students. Two. And the school today has 106 people. We will be graduating 17 of those people on Thursday. I want to make sure everybody can hear me. I just saw a note that people were having trouble hearing. Is everybody hearing me now? They're working on it. Okay. So some people can hear me and some people can't. So please turn up your sound as much as you can while we work on turning up our sound. Okay, how's that? Is that better for people? I can't tell. Yes, okay, so it's better for Sherry. Oops, making us vibrate, but that's okay. So I just want to remind you that we began 115 years ago with two students. And on Thursday, we graduate 17 students out of a school with 106 people in it, in a variety of programs, including a Master of Divinity program, certificate programs, and a Master of Arts in Social Change. So I give you that overview to let you know how important our work is, how much it matters in the world in which we live, and how committed all of us here at Star King are in making sure that Star King is here for another 115 years, because the work that we do is important. I know that some of the people online today are most likely current students and some donors. I see some donors' names up here. And some graduates, but I also know that there are probably some prospective students. And it's important for the prospective students in this group to understand that Star King is not closing. It is not fading away. It is very much alive and well, and is responding in a timely way to changes that are going on throughout the theological education universe. Unless you're Harvard or unless you're Liberty University, you are most likely a theological school that is having to make significant changes in the way that you educate and in the forms in which you educate. I just want to give you some examples based on what's happening at the GTU at this very moment. In the last month, the GTU has seen at least two schools change their way of being. The Episcopal school across the street has been taken over by the Trinity Wall Street group, which is Trinity Wall Street Church and its real estate holdings and business. It's a $6 billion church organization. And they are going to make it possible for CDSP, Church Divinity School of the Pacific, to be a seminary and leadership school in the West. They wanted a footprint on the West Coast. This was the most efficient way for them to do that. That's one example. The Presbyterian School, San Francisco Theological Seminary, has just been partnered with or is about to merge with the University of the Redlands in Washington State. And though they will remain here for the time being in San Anselmo, it is possible that on some future occasion they will relocate to a different site. In the last year, year and a half, the Lutheran School, PLTS, sold its magnificent campus to Zaytuna, which is the Muslim university here, right next door, and has become embedded in California Lutheran University in Southern California. They have rented a floor of an office building in downtown Berkeley, where they now have offices, classrooms, and a chapel, so that their footprint has changed. So this is happening all over the GTU. It's also happening across theological education. For example, the Divinity School, the Episcopal Divinity School in Cambridge, Massachusetts, relocated and embedded itself in Union Theological Seminary in New York. And we all know that Andover Newton basically became embedded into Yale, and it is now Andover Newton at Yale. So I'm just giving you examples of what's happening in theological education as a whole. It is profoundly expensive to educate people for ministry and related professions. And so it takes a kind of nimbleness and a willingness to look at new forms of education, to make it possible to continue that work. And since we're determined to continue the unique work that Star King does, and the unique way that we educate to counter oppression, that we work to help to create transformative theological education so that we can graduate 21st century religious leaders, in order to do those things, we are going to have to make some changes, become more nimble, do things in a way that we haven't done them before. So that is what the board and I have been engaged in. We have been looking at the financial challenges of the school. We've been looking at the educational model of the school. We've been looking at the building itself, because these are things we need to look at right now. Our goal has always been to do whatever changes we needed to do differently. Ordinarily, a school would not be talking about the kinds of changes we're thinking about until we were much farther along in the process. For example, nobody on the Hill knew about what was happening at the Episcopal school until it happened. Those of us who were the other presidents here on the Hill heard about it the day before. But most folks didn't know till we knew. Star King is a different kind of place. We're asking people about volumes. People still seem to be having volume problems. Star King's a different kind of place. And because we have always believed in a more transparent process in most of the things that we do here, it seemed right and sensible to talk to the community about the things we were beginning to consider, not at the end of the process, but at the beginning of the process. It's important to get feedback from our student communities and our alums and our donors, but especially our students, because as students, you all are the reason we're here. Without you, there is no Starcade. And so it was especially important for us to want to begin a conversation with you as we began to think about what might come next for the school. So that is a kind of preface about what I wanted to say. And I want to make sure that I answer as many questions as I can in the time that we have allotted to us. Some of the questions that came up this morning that I want to kind of lean into right now had to do with our relationships with the GTU and with CHI. And what I want to say is, for now, those relationships will not change. We have many students who are part of the CHI community who have been admitted to Starcade, a joint program, and that is not going to change. If it should change for some reason, we'll be sure to let you know, but we have no reason to believe that that will change right now. And we have no reason to believe that our relationship with the GTU will change. It's important to us to preserve your capacity to use the GTU library, whether you use it directly or through interlibrary loan or through digital resources. It's an important resource, and I would like to make sure that that keeps happening. And so the board and I are absolutely committed to that. And it's important for there to be a cross-registration capacity in what we do, because we are not the only school up here. We happen to have a little pride of place about how good we really are here, but we also believe in the importance of ecumenical and interreligious educational model, because that's part of what we do, and we can't do that without the other schools. So it's important to us to maintain that relationship. I also want to say, before I go any further, that this meeting is recorded, so that if you miss hearing anything or you wanted to hear it again or you called in late, this will be available to listen to shortly after we're done. So, and I'm going to rely on Xander and Matthew, who are in the room here managing Zoom, to help with keeping track of who's asking questions. And we also have Gabriella, our chief academic officer, and dean of faculty on the wall here, so that if there are things that are more particular to the academic side of the house, she'll be able to talk as well. So having said that, I'm looking forward to answering whatever questions you've got. What do we see? If you have a question and you've left and, you're visible to us, raise your hand or not, use the chat so that we know you want to ask questions. We have an in-the-room question from Ren. Come on up if you want. You want to ask a question from there?
Thank you. Thank you for doing this. I just really do value and appreciate as much transparency as possible. I think it is part of dismantling white supremacy, right? It's to be transparent. So if you're important to me, and I feel like just really appreciative that you're bringing this into the space. So that's all.
Thank you.
I was curious if there are any things that are in process or in decision-making mode, in terms of the building, in terms of certain things that you mentioned, what is kind of the trajectory of where things are going
Great, thanks for that. That's a good question. In case you didn't hear that, the question was about the trajectory around the building and what's in process around the building. So let me begin by saying that we are beginning the process of what's happening in the building. And it would be at least 1 year before we would leave the building if that is the decision that we ultimately make. So for those of you who have signed up for intensives in August, you will be coming to LeConte Avenue. And for those of you who are here coming in the spring, you'll be coming here as well. As soon as we have clarity about the status of the building, we will of course talk about that. But it will be, we imagine that it will take at least a year for us to settle on a final disposition about what we're going to do here. And part of what I want to say about the building is that as beloved as it is, it's expensive to run. It costs $100,000 a year just to open the doors every day. That has nothing to do with the deferred maintenance on the building or any of the other things and the quirky weird stuff about the heating system and why one room is roasting and the other room is freezing and all the other things that you've experienced if you've been here, right? And that's not necessarily conducive to long-term comfort for staff or students or faculty. And so we want to look at what our options might be. Who and where might there be a better situation for us? And that is an active part of one of three committees, and I want to talk about working groups of the board. So there are three working groups of the board. One of those working groups deals strictly with the financials, how much it costs to run the building, what some of the options are around the building, what makes sense, what would it take to find another place and lease it, that kind of thing. They're just running the numbers. One group is about partnerships, and we wanted to think along some of the lines that our colleagues here on the Hill are thinking. Do we have potential partners? Are there people who share our commitments to countering oppressions? Are there people who care about the same way about a multi-religious education or theological education? We want us to know, are there people that we could be talking to and that we might partner with in some way? So there's a whole group of us who are just looking at those. And then there are people who are working on what are the options around the educational model of the school. And what kind of changes might be required to go with some of the other changes that we might be making. How can we improve the technology around our distance learning? Is Zoom our best option or can we do better? What other kinds of things do we need? What kind of courses are we offering and should we be offering them in a different way or in different modalities? So we're looking at all of these things. And as I said to people this morning, the interconnected web of all existence of which we are a part is really an important metaphor for you to keep in mind, because whenever you do one part of the system or make a change in one part of the system, we're gonna need to make changes in other parts of the system. If you don't walk away with anything else, please know that it will not be just one change that we will need to make. We will need to make a variety of changes on a variety of levels to ensure the long-term sustainability of StarKit. So there's no magic bullet. Nobody's coming with a magic wand to tap anybody on the head to make this different. We're going to be moving through a lot of levels, and we expect that there will be different sections and segments of time that we will go through in order to get where we ultimately want to go. So that's another reason we wanted to begin this process, because we want you all to get used to the next level of the process, whatever that is. And we want to create this kind of habit and practice about, well, here we are at this point, and here's here's where we think we're going next, and here are the parts we're not sure about yet. So that you're traveling with us to the degree that that's possible. Because we are a place that's into transparency, we really want to make sure that you understand that there's some things we aren't able to talk about right now. Some because we actually don't know anything about them. Some because when you're in negotiation or conversation, negotiation is too strong a word because it's too soon. When you're in conversations about a possible partnership, people want a certain level of confidentiality about that, and we need to honor that. And the last thing I want to say is that for those of you who are interested in parish ministry or nonprofit work, this is a great example of ways you may have to conduct your own life later on. There will be things you will be doing and conversations you will be having, some of which you'll be able to share and some of which you won't be able to share, and steps you'll be able to take that you can see and steps that are not yet visible to you. And all of that is a part of creating this larger plan that we're working toward. That was a really long answer to that question, but I thought I better say it while I had a chance. Who's next? No questions?
It's a problem. You have such a complete answer.
Barbara. Hi, Barbara.
Hi. I guess I'm trying to understand what it is that's requiring you to make the changes. Is it mostly financial or is it something else?
Finances plays a big role, but it's not the only thing that is driving this change. We've noticed some things in enrollment and in the kinds of enrollment that we're getting. So last year, for example, was the first time that people who are low residency were more prevalent than people who were high residents here in the Bay. Up until now, we've had about 50-50, 60-40, depending on the year, it would go back and forth. We have people who would pick up wherever they were and they'd come here and they'd be high residents, they'd stay here for 3 years, they'd graduate, they leave. And then people who were distance learners. That has flipped. So we believe that there are a couple of things driving that mostly revolve around housing and the cost of living in the Bay Area. So that people who might have gone to school full-time are going to school part-time because they can't afford to go full-time and pay rent out here. And some people don't come out here at all. They just come for the intensives because they can't afford to go to school and live out here. So they become distance learners. So some of the impact that we are dealing with is about things we don't have any control over. We have no control over the housing emergency in California, but it has had a big impact on the way in which our students have to interact with the school. And we're trying to examine a few things, in part because one of our least favorite possibilities is becoming a school that is solely online. Meadville does it. Their students seem pleased with the model, but it's not necessarily our first choice about an educational model. So it is, of course, though, intertwined with the increasing expensive quality of theological education. So finances is definitely involved, but it's not the only thing. Does that help? Okay, great. Thank you. That's a great question. Anybody in here? Anybody out there? comments?
I have a question.
Who's that?
It's Bruce Beal.
Hi, Bruce. How are you?
I'm doing well, thanks. How are you?
Good, thank you. Glad you're here.
I'm wondering what recent changes have happened that you felt were good ones.
Say more about that.
Well, I'm not sure you're there, you're involved with this, and I'm not sure, you know, you've talked about that you're really looking at what needs to happen. My thing is always about sort of the instruction or the modes of learning, but maybe you could talk about that and how you might have made some innovations there.
Well, we're constantly thinking about the educational model. And Gabriella, our chief academic officer, is always talking about how we can improve the work that we do. I think I'm feeling really good about the kinds of courses that we teach and the people who are teaching them. I think we have an amazing faculty. And I also am continually pleased and amazed at the quality of the students who choose to come to Starkey. We have an extraordinarily accomplished group of people who uproot their lives or change their professions to come to school here. The student body is one of the great strengths of this school. And it has been long before I became president, and it has only continued since I've become president. The level of commitment that people have, not only to Unitarian Universalism, but to a multi-religious future, and to a future in which dismantling white supremacy is at the core of their ministry, is really inspiring to those of us who get to work here. And I think it's especially renewing and rejuvenating for those of us who work here because the rest of the world seems so depressing by comparison. When a lot of us sometimes want to lose hope about the future of this country and this world, I am always reminded that every year we graduate people who are doing their part to change the world that we live in, and who are doing it on the ground, face-to-face, people in a variety of settings. We have people going into the military to be chaplains at a time when most military chaplains are evangelical Christians, even as the actual military forces become more diverse in so many ways. We have people who are trying to seek out parish ministry and to do parish ministry differently. And we have folks who are getting their Master of Arts in Social Change who are going to go out and start nonprofits and take up work that people ordinarily would shy away from. So of all the things I get to do, Thursday night is gonna be pretty great because I get to listen to some of the graduates talk about their inspiration and their and for now, that's the thing that keeps me getting up in the morning. Excited
about what else we can do here.
Gabriella would like to add a few words.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Yes, I wanted to add a segment to your to Rosemary's answer to the last question. I think one of the things that is exciting to see is the fact that we are at the end of a 2-year process of self-study that we
to initiate because of the request of our accrediting organization, the Association of Theological School. And I think that report that will be made public once it's final shows, you know, with qualitative and quantitative information that we fulfill our educational mission, and in remarkable ways. And we also have very good ideas about growing ages and how we are addressing them. So while in the same report, there is also the story about the financial challenges in this particular socio-political moment, there is also very interesting material about everything that Rosemary just said about the work of our students and faculty. So through the work of assessment, I think that is not, you know, it's been very systematic work of gathering data and reviewing them. And that has been exciting to see that actually we do what we say we do for the most part, and that we have the work, the artifacts, the feedback of the students to back that up.
Thanks for that. Thanks for asking that question, Bruce. Did that help? More questions? Yes. We have a question in the room.
I have like three.
Okay, you can ask three. We don't have a limit on them.
And thank you for, this is Lauren, for those who are on the screen. Thank you for just doing a lot around the information you've already provided. You answered so already. The first question is, do any of these changes affect giving or receiving the endowment funds that school has received, will receive in the future in relation to potential new partnerships, old partnerships that we may have lost, donors that we may have lost? And then the second question is kind of related to that. Do we currently have any partnerships that you're willing to address with us? And does the UU Church involve itself at all with funding at this specific school?
So let me answer that middle one, which is do we have any partnerships that I can talk about now? The answer is no, not yet. Because we really aren't being in conversations. We aren't even at negotiation part, we're at conversation part. Mm-hmm. We're just kind of exploring people that we think might be interesting. I can tell you that one of the first things we did was we looked at schools that had Unitarian or Universalist origins as a possible first place to look. Unitarians started lots of colleges. They lost a lot of that history since then, because they're largely secular, but Reed College was started by Unitarian, so was Stanford. They were all U's. They were not Universalists, they were Unitarian. So, but there's a lot of colleges in the country that have Unitarian Universalist origins. But we started looking at some of those, and we started looking on the West Coast because half of our student body comes from those states, Oregon, Washington, and California. And we knew that if we had at least half of our students from there, it would be a much more disruptive thing to think about partnerships that were further afield. We are pretty sure, I don't want to say never because we don't know what's ahead fully, but it'd be safe to say that we're confining our partnership search for now to the state of California, and most likely the Bay, because Southern California is kind of a reach for us, There's nothing that immediately opens itself up as a possibility. But there are lots of things that, you know, are, that people are looking at that may bear fruit. So we don't, I don't want to say never, but I would say if I had to talk about it right this minute, that we were unlikely to confine our search for partners in the north, in Northern California area. That's the first thing I can say. Other than that, I can't talk about it because there's not a lot to say about it yet. Very much a conversation to be had. You asked about UUA support. Unlike many denominations, the Unitarian Universalist Association does give us, and as well as Meadville, some financial support. It's about a tenth of our budget, a little less than a tenth, I guess, because our budget is roughly $3 million a year. We get about $210,000 from the UUA. That comes from a group called the Panel on Theological Education. And their purpose is to distribute funds that were donated to it in the 1980s from the congregation at Shelter Rock to support theological education. They are well aware of the challenges that schools face. And they meet with us twice a year in October and in April. So I had this conversation with the panel in April. They have been supportive of our efforts to wrestle with some of these knotty problems. Meadville had this sequence of events happen about 5 to 7 years earlier. They solved their challenges by selling their properties on the University of Chicago campus and leasing 2 floors in a building in downtown Chicago with a view of the lake. Truly gorgeous. Right. I've been there, it's so pretty. Can't lie. And those sales strengthened an endowment for them. We don't have multiple buildings to sell. We have this building, and we are evaluating at this very moment the highest and best use of this space. And we don't fully have an answer to that. But that is one of the groups. That's one of the things that one of the groups is working on. Looking at what the many options are about this property. It's always difficult when you have to think about those things because some possibilities are more bittersweet than others. But there hasn't been a decision made, and there probably won't be one made in the immediate future. It may be different 6 months from now. And as I said, even if we made the decision tomorrow, it would take us a year just to get out of the building, I'm guessing, if that were what we were gonna do. We do expect that we will have to leave this building, but we are not sure about our destination or about why we would be leaving this building. We'd be leaving this building to lease it, to sell it, to do something else. And as I said, all these things go together. So to make one choice needs to do some other choices. So we'll have this weird kind of interconnected effect. You asked me something else, and I'm trying to. Scholarship funds are restricted funds. They can only be spent for scholarships. We have roughly an upward of $250,000 with scholarship money in a variety of ways that we can divvy up. Some we can only give in full scholarships, some we can give out partial. And we're always out looking for more, always. Jessica and I, Jessica Cloud is our Vice President for Advancement, and we are hard at work looking at the kinds of things we might need to do to increase our impact with donors to introduce the school to people who might not know about who we are and what we do. One of the things I'm trying to do is crack the foundations piece. That's been the part that's been the most difficult for us to crack. Every March, Gabrielle and I are furiously writing grants, and so far we haven't cracked that. I just reconnected with someone I knew 30 years ago who just retired from the foundation world. So she and I are having coffee on Thursday morning because she believes that there are foundations who will care about a school that has an interest in dismantling white supremacy culture, which is news to me. I didn't think there were. She seems to think there are. So we're definitely having coffee Thursday morning, right? So Jessica and I are constantly thinking about who do we need to be in front of? Who haven't we met yet? Who should we be introduced to? And so we're talking to people about who needs to meet us? Who needs to hear our story? Who needs to meet our graduates, right? So that's an ongoing process. So if you all know anybody that you think we ought to know, don't hesitate to send me an email. Jessica and I will get on a plane. I've already told my husband not to look for me in the month of October. Jessica has booked me all up and down the East Coast. And the other thing we need to do, and already knew that we need to do, which is make ourselves become familiar to people who ordinarily don't know about Starkey in different parts of the country. So there are not a lot of people in the East Coast who knew about Starkey. So we really are trying to work the Eastern Seaboard. So we'll be in Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York, and Boston in 2 weeks in October. We're trying to begin to work the South a little bit, North Carolina in particular, but some other places as well. So we're trying to make ourselves known to people who didn't know we were out. So, does that help?
Yeah.
Okay. Barbara's got another question.
I have another question. Yes. How can people get involved in this process? Or is there a role for, say, a graduate to get involved in this if we have time in order to be able to participate?
At this juncture, we're not clear about everything that needs to happen yet. So this immediate time period, we're asking people to send their ideas and their suggestions to future@sksm.edu. And we read every email. They come to me, they come to the chair of the board, they come to our communications officer, Xander Hoffman. And they get distributed to people who might need to see that. Some ideas we get, Jessica sees. People have been writing to that. After this morning's meeting, I got a couple of really interesting ideas from people about ways of thinking and conceptualizing what school might look like in a different formulation. Hadn't thought about it that way. Don't know if anything will come of it. But that's the kind of help that we will need in this short term right now. Once we get farther along, the board working groups may need more assistance from people who want to be part of a team. But I don't know the answer to that, and I won't know until the board thinks that over. Board already has working groups, but we may need extra hands. Depending on what the solutions are that we begin to pursue. So if people are interested in being on a future team, send us that email at future@sksm.edu and we will make sure that you're on the list for things. And if you have a specific kind of expertise that you think would be helpful, that would help us a lot. Because maybe we'll need somebody with help around real estate, or maybe we need somebody in some other arena that we haven't conceived of, but if we know that there are people out there, that would help us a lot. And thanks for volunteering. Other thoughts or questions? Oh, okay.
I'm Ren, by the way.
Ren's here. Ask the question.
One question I had is, it sounds like you all are not interested, which was a little bit of my fear, why I wanted to come, you're not interested in the model because of that shift, and like most people are distance and there aren't as many like folks that are in the Bay Area learning. It sounds like the school's not interested in going in the model of like fully transforming into distance learning. But are there models that you are looking at that are different from what exists, what Star King is doing right now, that would be more in line with kind of where things are headed or what makes more sense financially, et cetera?
So we haven't settled on any models, but let me say that some of the things we're looking at, some of the arenas we're looking at is, one, can we utilize General Assembly in a different way? We got this idea because we teach the polity class at GA, right? And we don't want to interfere with the polity class at GA because that takes all GA. It starts Wednesday and Sunday, everybody's falling out, they're burnt to a crisp, they don't want to take any more class. But someone suggested, what would happen, for example, if we had a mini intensive? If we did mini intensives in the city that we were doing GA, we did it before GA. So that you start the weekend before and end on Monday afternoon, so that people who are ministers or part of the UMA could keep going and go on into their UMA meetings and then go to General Assembly. That's just one idea that somebody had. And we also were thinking about, can we do more with the model that we used to teach ministry in times of disaster, where it's a mini weekend, it's a long weekend for two sessions or three sessions. Because what we're trying to do is figure out, how do we utilize different configurations and get credit hours that will be appropriate? One of the reasons we can't make decisions about that yet is our accrediting body. When you teach a certain way, ATS has to approve that way. ATS is in the middle of evaluating us in September and changing its standards for the entire theological school universe starting in 2021, I believe. And so one of the things we anticipate is that they're going to liberalize and make more flexible the way theological schools teach. And we're looking forward to that because that will help guide some of what we do. They'll give us some advance notice about what that might look like, but that will give us some ideas about different configurations of classes that would allow us to have maximum flexibility. So that's just the little tiny pieces that we kind of are talking about. There are other ways to think about this. Do we do intensives? Do we do them more often? Do we do other kinds of things? Gabrielle, is there anything that you want to add to that?
Yes, all of that. And also, as long as we are part of the Graduate Theological Union, one of the trends that we see is that after, having been the first people that experimented and become very proficient with online and hybrid courses, other schools are now very quickly increasing exponentially the number of online courses that they create. And so that means that in terms of co-registration, we came from a time where the GTU were not supporting our Laura students much to the possibility of having many more options for students. And that will also make a difference. It's just one thing among many, but definitely it's an important factor at the moment to see how the whole GTU is changing and what are the offering that will make a difference to our students that will take place because of these changes.
Thank you.
I have a curiosity question. This is Erica.
Hi, Erica.
Hi there. Could you say something about what the current enrollment is in semester-long in-residence classes? So you've talked about last year being the first year that this low-res, high-res has tipped, but I'm just curious if there are many people in classrooms during the semester time.
Yes, I mean, yeah, it depends on the class, but they are still, the classes that we offer are still, you know, really, you know, there are mostly, they have a good number of students in them, you know, 15, 10, depending on the course and the subject matter, but there are still students around, and the limited course, high residency or hybrid courses we offer, they are well attended. Patterns in who is attending stacking in which modality change quickly. Just over 3 years ago, we had suddenly, after a time when we saw the number of the law residency students increase, we had an entering class where the majority were high residency students. So we have to be able to adjust to the fact that that beat the trend. Right now, I don't envision that happening often, but I think as long as we keep in our model the ability to teach in high res and low res, we need to, you know, during the semester, we need to be able to adjust to that possibility. Also, having said that, we have also a policy to cancel courses if they're undersubscribed, even a pre-registration, if we have a good reason to believe that there won't be enough people. But that's very rare. Classes are, you know, courses are still attended, and many classes that are in high residence are actually hybrid, so people can also attend them from Zoom. So there's very little that is only, even that you offer within the building, that is only for people on campus. And I think as with the improvement of technology, I mean, if we keep this modality, our classes will become better and better able to include both high-res and low-res students synchronously in the same space, in the same virtual space.
Thank you. You invited comments earlier, and this one probably goes without saying, but as a low-res student myself, I would just say that I really appreciate the flexibility of online courses, and in my experience, as much as we try, the quality in terms of what I take away, there's just really no comparison. And I would also just throw out, I don't know what the numbers are in terms of those of us who are joint program students with CHI, but I notice how many Star King students come in and out of the CHI classroom, and I'm wondering if there's some opportunity there for intensives, much like you're talking about with GA, right? Where people are in town and showing up for CHI courses already, you know, those on a monthly basis. Anyway, so I really appreciate all the questions you're asking, and I was not shocked to see the original announcement. It all makes a lot of sense. There's some nervousness too, of course, right? And it's sort of the state of the world. And so I appreciate everything you're doing.
Thank you, Erica. We have time for one or two more questions before we sign off. Okay. Well, if there aren't any more questions, I just want to close with this. it's been the joy of my life to see and to serve Star King for about 25 years now, off and on. I first came into the fireside room 25 years ago with a nursing infant as a brand new board member. That nursing infant is now 25. And I find myself back here, really excited about the work that we do here, the difference that we make in the world, not just because of the work we do in terms of the people we graduate, but the impact that our graduates have on Unitarian Universalism. Because when you consider the willingness of our faith tradition to have, for the first time, a significant conversation about the dismantling of white supremacy culture, and you look at the people who serve in institutional Unitarian Universalism at 24 Farnsworth, you will see an extraordinary number of Star King graduates, practically the entire Department of Ministry graduated from this school. So it is no accident that our movement is taking seriously what we have taken seriously for a quarter of a century. And so I am committed to my goals in making sure that we continue to do the work we have been doing so that our movement and the larger world continues to change. Because change is no longer optional. So I want to thank all of you for signing on and being here and being willing to go with us on this fantastic voyage. It is a little scary, but it's also exciting because I have a lot of faith in where we're going to land. And I'm so glad you're traveling with us. Please make sure that if you have more questions, you think of something tonight, or you got a comment you want to make, that you write to future@sksm.edu. Like I said, we read everything. And we'll get back to you. And we are grateful for you. Take care, everybody.